Teacher's Coffee with George Kokolas and Virginia Dooley.
Well, I'm laughing because this is another very special episode, and this time that we are recording right now, we have realized that our guest is somehow 9 hours behind us, and we are 9 hours ahead of him. So in Honduras right now is midnight, whether in Europe it's 9 o'clock a.m. And welcome, Gina. Another Hello. Teacher's coffee.
Thank you. Bright and early for us, nice and late for our guest. But our guest comes from a very exotic place, so I almost wish I was there with her. I've never been there. So our guest today is from exotic Honduras.
Exactly.
And her name is... Do you want to present? Yeah, go on. Long name.
I want to present because... I've met her before, not in person, never in person, but we have coincided in several conferences. I know that she's a very active person. And as you said, to me, Honduras also sounds so exotic. So I would love to know more, both about her and her country. So we are very happy to have here with us together, Grazzia Maria Mendoza Chirinos from Honduras. Grazzia, welcome to Teacher's Coffee.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for the invitation to share and learn together and talk a little bit about Honduras and talk a little bit about me. I'm really happy to be part of this interview today.
Wonderful. Okay, geographically, we know where Honduras is. It's in Central America, but you know, we need some pictures from your country. And if then gradually are going to make it more specifically into ELT, but how is Honduras? I mean, and then you can tell us a little bit about your story there.
So I can be a little bit biased because I love my country. So it is a wonderful country. It has different climates. We're fortunate to have different climates depending on where you go in the country. It's usually warm and tropical because we are, like you said, in Central America. And I always like to say that we are in the heart of the American continent because we are like just in the middle of mm-hmm. the continent. And we have different areas. We have like the north area and the south area where we have the beaches. If you go north, you're going to find Caribbean beaches, white sand, blue sea, transparent. If you go south, and people usually think of the south as that they don't like it a lot because the sand is volcanic sand because of the little island of Amapala that is there, but other people enjoy that. And if you're located in the capital city, I am from the capital city, so and if you're located there, you're a 2-hour drive to the south beaches and a 4-hour drive to the north beaches. So you have from the center of the country, go inside. We want to go to the beach for the weekend, and we just take a car and go to the beach. So we also have mountains, and we are able to do now with this sports and adventures that are very risky and dangerous. People do canopy and do all kinds of stuff in the mountains in the western region. And we have a special department. We divide our country in 18 departments, and we have a special department called Intibucá, which actually has cold weather, and the temperatures can go all the way down to 4 degrees or -0 sometimes. And we have had very special years when it has actually kind of snowed a little bit, like not snow, like very a lot of inches of snow, but like a little bit of I don't know, you can see the little specks of snow, and people say, oh, it's snowing. So that's something that happens every, I don't know, not often. And then to the east, we also have the jungle. And this is usually not a place that people often visit because the access can be very expensive and it can be a little bit complex. But we're fortunate to have different, a rich tradition. We are fortunate to have different types of dishes depending on where we go. And people always say, well, our dishes are better than the others, right? Like in every country. We like every country does, and I have found this when I have traveled and talked to people from other countries. We also have the other country. Our other country is Olancho, and that's located in the east part. Like it's the biggest department and where a lot of production happens. We have a rich indigenous tradition as well, although unfortunately we have not been very good at protecting their languages and their customs. So we have not done a very good job there. Lately, people have started to work on this, but we have not very good at that. In the western region, we have the Copan ruins that describe the whole Mayan culture, and that extends all the way to Guatemala and Mexico as well. We are a very religious country also, mostly Catholic, so people enjoy all those traditional holidays and religious traditions. Our food is delicious. If you ever come to Honduras, a must is to try baleadas. And baleadas is a flour tortilla with fried beans and cream. So if you come to Honduras, you have to try that. If you don't try that, you have never been to Honduras. So that's a must.
That's wonderful because the way you describe it, I think Gina should book a ticket to Honduras. And
Yeah,
actually,
it
yeah.
really you did convince me. There's all these things to do and the different parts of the country as well. It really sounds very exotic and interesting. We have to. George, have you been?
No,
You've been to so many
it's
places.
yeah, it's one flag that I miss from Latin America. But
Ah, okay.
Grazia, tell us a little bit about yourself, because apart from coming from a fascinating country, you are also a very fascinating person. I have to give this testimony here to our listeners. You are very active on social media, very positive all the time, smiling, doing things, very creative. You are also very much involved with the Association of Teachers. So tell us a little bit about yourself and your career.
So I have been an educator for 30 years. I have been fortunate to teach all levels. I have taught pre-kinder, elementary, secondary, higher education. I was a higher education professor for 12 years. I have also been a teacher trainer for 15 years. I have had the chance to work with teachers all over the world through TESOL and different TESOL affiliates. I have This has helped me understand that as teachers and as language educators, our challenges are pretty similar, right? And our contexts are different. So we can find that common ground when we talk about things and we can share lessons learned and best practices. I have been involved with TESOL International Association since 2007. This is my professional home. I was part of the board from 2019 to 2022, and it was a great experience for me. But I have volunteered with the association since the very moment that I joined, and it has been a very rewarding experience. It's been a win-win situation for me because I have learned a lot and I have been able to give a lot. So that's really important for me as a professional and as a person. And because of my engagement with TESOL International, the US Embassy in 2014, in the US Embassy here in Tegucigalpa asked me if I could work on putting together the local Honduran Association. And at first I was like, wow, that's a lot of work. And they said, well, we have this money here. We want to fund this initiative. Can you do that? We did it with a group, a small group of people, and in 2014 we founded HELTA TESOL. It's the Honduran English Language Teacher Association, and we have been going on strong for 9 years. This in November 25th, we're gonna have our ninth online convention, and next year, which is going to be our 10th anniversary, we're going to have our in-person convention. So you're invited. It's gonna be in Copan, so you're gonna be able to look at the ruins and everything if you come. So you're invited to that.
Why not?
Wow.
Yeah.
Sounds exciting. So that's very interesting. Tell us a bit more about like what's the most common way for someone like a student to learn English in Honduras? Is it evening schools? Is it in the main curriculum of the school? Like what's the most common way the students get exposed to English?
There are many ways that people learn English in Honduras. We are fortunate that we have, usually countries have one binational center, but we are fortunate that we have two binational centers, and one is located in the north of the country and the other one is located in the capital. And these binational centers have like little satellite schools in other departments, but we also have other language centers. And this would be like for young adults or adults who want to learn English, like you said, during the evening or in weekend programs. But schools, we also have a lot of bilingual schools. I think there was a last count of bilingual schools in 2015, and we had around 800 bilingual schools out of the 14,000 schools that are in the education system in Honduras. So there are plenty of bilingual schools, and people, we have that historical connection to the U.S. because we are in the same geographical area, and people attend bilingual schools, and bilingual schools can vary in terms of quality, but we have the big bilingual schools with those popular names, very expensive. And we also have the smaller bilingual schools. So there are many ways in which people can learn English. There are also private services. Sometimes teachers offer private classes to small groups of people. And in public schools, there's a mandate from the Ministry of Education that you need to start learning English from the fourth grade. It was going to be moved to the first grade, but right now it's from the fourth grade. That doesn't happen like it should, but the mandate is there. And there are different types of teachers that work in those different contexts, and they have different maybe proficiency levels, also different types of certifications. So that's more or less how people learn English in Honduras.
Absolutely, Graciela. And I'm a little surprised because when somebody listens, at least in Europe, the term bilingual school, as you said, the first thing that comes to your mind is something really expensive and something that people cannot afford. But it looks as though that there is a more massive, let's say, offer regarding a bilingual school, and it's something affordable maybe for more people than, you know, maybe in other countries. And this is good because once you attend a bilingual school, automatically you boost your language skills at a very, very high level. But irrespective of all these offer, and I guess state schools, you know, they do their thing as well and their contribution, what would be the first motive for someone to learn right now English in Honduras? I mean, what is the general consensus of the people? What is the intrinsic motivation that would bring a person, an individual, adult, or maybe not, to come to you and say, look, I want to learn this language? Is it because of this relationship with the United States? Maybe exams, maybe professional reasons? How would you define that?
So first is that connection, historical, that we have had to the United States, right? People, we have been connected. There's a saying or something that we reflect upon in our country, that in Honduras, every family has at least one person in the United States, whether they have migrated regularly or irregularly. Mm-hmm. And so people are interested in learning the language for those reasons. But in addition, over the last maybe 20 years, the private sector and businesses have made it sort of a requirement in their, when they advertise positions in the workplace, that people should speak a certain level of English, depending on the position that they are applying to. So people are interested because of professional reasons. Sometimes people see the, and sometimes they might not use the language as much in that workplace, but they see it as an added value. So they think that somebody that has the ability to speak another language is going to be added value for the business. Also, some people want to travel. Others want to secure a job abroad. So that happens also, that people want to have secure jobs abroad. In the case of students, for example, they want to go to master's programs or PhD programs in English-speaking countries. and not necessarily only the United States, but anywhere that where English is spoken. And especially now that universities are writing agreements with universities in other countries, there's an interest in also learning other languages like French and maybe German, and making sure that people have access to those languages in order to study in other countries and have participate in exchange programs or things like that. I think that from Central America, we are the country with the highest interest in learning English. When I've talked to people in South America, it's a little bit lower, but I think in our area, like in Central America, we are the ones that have the highest interest in learning English for all those reasons that I mentioned.
All right, cool. So mostly professional reasons, you would say, or to travel. So not so much at younger ages, it's because they have to, because it's a mandate, right, that you mentioned before. Okay, yeah, that makes sense. But what about the teachers? Because you mentioned that there's the bilingual schools and also there's the language schools or the private offerings. What type of teachers teach in these programs? Like, what are their I don't know, their background, is there opportunity for them to develop further? Is there like a certain criteria that they need to meet? How does it work in Honduras? And of course, I know that there has been for the past 9 years opportunity since HELTA has been developed. But in general, how would you assess the conditions?
So the teachers are different depending on where they teach. If they teach in a bilingual school or if they teach in a language center, the profile of the teacher might be a high school graduate that has the proficiency skills because they graduated from a bilingual school. And sometimes they don't have a certification, but the schools might train them and provide training for them, especially for the pedagogical aspect, because they have very good proficiency skills. They don't see a need to train them in their area, but on the area of pedagogical methodological skills. If we talk about the public school system, that's a whole different story. In our country, the Spanish teacher, according to our curriculum, they are able to teach Spanish, English, and arts, whether they are certified in as long as they are certified in one of those areas. So that means that if I'm an English teacher, I should be able to teach Spanish and I should be able to teach arts according to our curriculum. Yeah, but what is usual is that we have, and especially in elementary, we have Spanish teachers who are teaching English. And they are teaching English because of that thing in our system, in our curriculum. But they are also teaching English because maybe they traveled and stayed in the US for 6 months and they know a little bit of vocabulary and they're doing a lot of grammar translation and vocabulary lists in the classroom. That's in elementary. In secondary, it's a little bit different because the National Pedagogical University has students with bachelor's degrees in teaching English. So in secondary, it's a little bit different. They are specialized, they are certified, they have their university diploma. Some of them even have master's programs. In 2012, there was the Fundamental Law of Education was passed, and this was supposed to change this because it was going to be a requirement that everybody in the public school system should at least have an undergraduate degree in teaching pre-primary, primary or secondary. And they should have that higher education diploma in their discipline. That has not happened completely. It has moved very slowly. This was supposed to be completed by 2016, but we are still in 2023 and things are still moving slowly. So as you can see, we have teachers that sometimes have the certifications, but sometimes they don't. And a big challenge that we have is that we don't have a national professional development system. So that means the teachers need to seek professional development on their own, and especially in the public system, private school system, bilingual school system, that's not usually a problem because the schools are going to seek professional development for their teachers. But in the public school system, that's where we have the biggest challenges. And this is our biggest population in terms of teachers and in terms of students. So this is where the highest need is. So there are not many opportunities. the biggest issue with our Ministry of Education is that their budget, 92% of their budget goes to salaries. So as you can see, there's not a lot of money then to implement important actions to support quality of education. There are international donors that help our Ministry of Education, but that's not enough, right? The Ministry of Education needs to do their job, and sometimes they're not doing that as they should be doing that. And there are several efforts, like USAID has worked with the Ministry of Education to support them with materials, with teacher training, but still, that's not enough. HELTA, we have trained over the last 9 years over 3,000 teachers, but we still feel that there are many gaps that need to be filled and many challenges that need to be addressed.
Wonderful. And with these comments that you have just made, you're giving me a great pass, you know, for my next question. So you as Graziella right now, maybe through HELTA or as an individual initiative, what would you change if you had the authority so to improve the Honduran ELT?
Well, I think the first thing is have that professional development system in place. That is something that needs to be done among different partners. And of course, with the collaboration and the Ministry of Education at the center. I think, and especially in English, in teaching English, what I would add is we need a major revision of our standards and a comprehensive set of materials that goes along with that. Our curriculum, our last curriculum is from 2000, that's 23 years ago, and it was not implemented fully. So even that has not, we don't know if it worked because it was never implemented completely. And then, but we have standards that are not aligned with what's happening in the classroom and with the materials that they are getting. And teachers are not getting the right level of a professional development that they need. So there are a lot of things, there are a lot of pieces of the puzzle that need to go into place in order to have a very solid foundation for our teachers and for our learners. So I would say, like, if I would go, and the first thing that I would do is to have that revision of the standards, alignment of materials and the outcomes that we want our learners to meet in terms of English learning, and have everything that the teachers need. We understand that we are not a country that has a lot of resources, so we have to adapt to that context. But there are things that can be done through partnerships, and there is value in having those partnerships. With HELTA, for example, we have done things with the US Embassy for a long time, but we have also engaged in partnerships with the British Council. And because of that work, we have supported teachers, for example, in developing their proficiency skills, in developing confidence to teach in the classroom, because we find that sometimes, because teachers don't have access to continuous professional development, their confidence can feel like threatened sometimes, right? And we have been able to work with the British Council in that, and the last project that we have been working with them this year has been on designing materials, and it's a pilot of materials that are suited for the student's context, and we have focused in right now in 4th through 6th grade and secondary education. And but this is like a little bit, and there's a bigger effort that needs to be made, and I think revising those standards and going into that. It is a long-term project, but it's something that can be done maybe in the next 5 to 10 years.
But Grazia, you know, I think from what you have, we've been listening very attentively for almost half an hour. I think you're very passionate about what you're doing. And I think that you are an example of what we call individual change that needs to be the beginning of a collective change as well. Because as you said, this is just a tiny fraction of what someone could change. You need to have more followers. You need to get more people to help you. And I think that's one of the main reasons why we're having this podcast, not only to get to know Honduras and you, but, you know, all this contribution and all this work that you're doing there needs to go out so maybe more people can actually help. Not only in Honduras, in other countries as well, and help teachers of English, you know, improve their conditions, and because this will automatically reflect to the students. So thank you for all these things that you have shared here today, but we haven't finished. We have a small surprise for you, And
One
this
more.
yeah, one
One more
more.
question, one more roast question, as we like to call it on this podcast. Are you ready for the last question of the show? It's a bit more personal, not so generic, let's say. Okay, so the question is, what was the most challenging interaction you've had during your career? And how did you deal with it?
Challenging interaction in terms of like
In terms of
what I
like you,
do.
yeah, or maybe questioning about, I don't know, your knowledge or your position, or I'm sure you've done a lot of teacher trainings you mentioned before, or you taught as well, maybe in a classroom something challenging came up, unexpected.
I think I have a very good community, and I always like to tell people I'm not I am not a positively I am always positive, and my interactions are usually positive, even when something bad can happen. But I'm not toxically positive. I want to make that clear. But I like to see silver linings in things that happen. But I think when you ask me that question, I like to think about how, and I would encourage people to do this, how connecting with people from other parts of the world really broadens and opens your mind to other perspectives and other ideas. And it really makes you challenge your own biases and prejudices in terms of thinking that, and especially in Honduras, our country, people like to think like, we're a poor country, we cannot do anything, nothing can happen here. And people usually seem very negative. And I like to tell people, yes, we are a poor country, we're a small country, we're a violent country, but there are things that can be done. And we might want to sit down and just mellow in the negative, but if we start thinking about little positive changes that we can make, then we can get out of that negativity and actually make a change. And I like in my Facebook, and George was saying is at the beginning, I like to post positive things about my country. So people usually complain, it's like everything, nothing is working here, and the system is ruined and broken. But I like to post things like great things that people are doing and recognize what people are doing. And I always like to post things about Hondurans that are have being successful all over the world or in Honduras, and I post Orgullo Hondureño, Noticias Positivas de Nuestro País, and that's Honduran pride, right? Successful and Hondurans from our country and good news from our country. So I like to say that because it is very easy to focus on the negative stuff because as humans, like we are kind of built that way. But sometimes looking at the positive takes a little bit of time. And from my interactions with people from all over the world, I have found that we are not that different. We are all humans. We are imperfect. We make mistakes. But many of us are seeking ways to improve our world and to make it a better place. And especially, I think language educators, we are special because we make a positive impact in the lives of people. We're not only teaching them another language, be it English or be it another language, we're teaching them or we're helping them explore the culture and the traditions of another place, of another language that really is going to open their minds to great things. So I don't think that I focus on negative things, but I focus more on positive things. But I'm not toxic in terms of being
That's a
positive.
beautiful, that's a beautiful way to end this podcast. I'm sure George really appreciates your answer, as he's a Mr. Positive man as well.
Absolutely. And I'm going to contribute and say something else, which it cannot be coincidental. I woke up today at 7 o'clock. I went for my morning walk. I listened to an amazing audiobook by Ryan Nemec, who is the father of the character strengths. He said exactly the same thing that Graciela says now. I had another conversation with my wife watching a TV show just before this podcast started. We had the same conversation, and now Graciela mentions it. It's very natural. Through the negative, you're going to find the positive because that's life. you cannot expect that everything is going to be positive. And the way you work with that and you face that is what makes you a positive person. And it's exactly what you, Graciela, are doing. Yeah, by posting these positive things, it's not something toxic or something that you're doing for with an agenda. You are tweaking the negative in a way, and you create positive feelings, maybe during a negative day for many people in the world. And we need to thank you for that.
Thank you. Yeah, it's very important to remain positive in the face of challenging circumstances, because there are challenging circumstances all over the world.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yeah. 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 Couldn't agree more. Well, I hope all of our listeners today have a positive remaining of the day. And thank you so much for joining us. Grazia. It's been a pleasure. Hopefully we can come to Honduras as well and learn even more about you and your country.
Next year, November, we have a date in Honduras, in Copan, to get to know the Copan ruins, but also for great professional development.
Absolutely.
For the 10 years. Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you so much. All the best.
Thank you.